think that the consumer and industry, and whatever industry it is, your company or others like yours, share that responsibility. So I appreciate you, both your patience and your preparation coming in today. But in response to the questions from a few of my colleagues related to the illegal drug ads, I have to admit that there were times when I was thinking, his answers aren't very reassuring to me. And I'm wondering what your answer would be as to how quickly you could take down an illegal drug site if there was $1 million per post per day regulation fine tied to it. In other words, give it your best. I mean, don't wait for somebody to flag it. Look for it. Make it a priority. It's certainly far more dangerous than a couple of conservative Christian women on TV. So please, be better than this.
Congressman, I agree with very important, and I miscommunicated if I left the impression that we weren't proactively going to work on tools to take down this content and we're only going to rely on people to flag it for us. Right now, I think underway, we have efforts to focus not only on ads, which has been most of the majority of the questions, but a lot of people share this stuff in groups too, and the free part of the products that aren't paid, and we need to get that content down too. I understand how big of an issue this is. Unfortunately, the enforcement isn't perfect. We do need to make it more proactive, and I'm committed to doing that.
And I don't expect it to be perfect, but I do expect it to be a higher priority than conservative thought. Speaking of that, I think in some of your responses to Senator Cruz yesterday and some responses today related to liberal bias, you've sort of implied the fact that while you have these 20,000 enforcement folks, you've implied that the Silicon Valley, perhaps this was more yesterday, that Silicon Valley is a very liberal place, and so the talent pool perhaps leans left in its bias. Let me suggest that you look someplace, perhaps in the middle of the North American continent, for some people. Maybe even your next big investment of capital could be in some place like, say, Bismarck, North Dakota, or Williston, where you have visited, where people tend to be pretty common sense and perhaps even more diverse than Facebook in some respects. If the talent pool is a problem, then let's look for a different talent pool, and maybe we can even have a nice big center someplace. I want to then close with this, because you testified yesterday, and the opening statement by the ranking member of the committee bothered me, and that suddenly there's this great concern that the providers, particularly Facebook, other large edge providers and content providers, should be hyper-regulated. When all along we as Republicans have been talking about net neutrality, we talked about earlier this year when we rolled back the internet service provider privacy stuff that seemed tilted heavily in your favor and against them. Don't you think that ubiquitous platforms like Google and Facebook and many others should have the same responsibility to privacy as an internet service provider?
Congressman, let me answer that in a second. And before I get to that, on your last point, the content reviewers who we have are not primarily located in Silicon Valley. So I think that was an important point. And
it
I do worry about the general bias of people in Silicon Valley, but the majority of the folks doing content review are around the world in different places. To your question about net neutrality, I think that there's a big difference between internet service providers and platforms on top of them. And the big reason is that, well, I just think about my own experience. When I was starting Facebook, I had one choice of an internet service provider. Uh-huh. And if I had to potentially pay extra in order to make it so that people could have Facebook as an option for something that they used, then I'm not sure that we'd be here today. Platforms, there are just many more. So it may be true that a lot of people choose to use Facebook. The average American, I think, uses about 8 different communication and social network apps to stay connected to people. It just is clearly correct or true that there are more choices on platforms. So even though they can reach large scale, I think the pressure of just having one or two in a place does require us to think a little bit
differently. I would submit to you that I have fewer choices on the platform, in your type of a platform, than I do in the internet, even in rural North Dakota. With that, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I suppose you don't want to hang around for another round of questions. Just kidding. Mr. Dr. Berg.
Isn't he funny?
Your staff, several of them just passed out behind you. You know, on a serious note, as we close, I would welcome your suggestions of other technology CEOs we might benefit from hearing from in the future for a hearing on these issues. As we look at net neutrality, as we look at privacy issues, these are all important. They're very controversial. We're fully cognizant of that. We want to get it right. And so we appreciate your comments and testimony today. There are no other members that haven't asked you questions, and we're not doing a second round. So seeing that, I just want to thank you for being here. I know we agreed to be respectful of your time. You have been respectful of our questions, and we appreciate your answers and your candor. As you know, some of our members weren't able to ask all the questions they had, so they'll probably submit those in writing. And we would like to get answers to those back in a timely manner. I'd also like to include the following documents be submitted for the record by unanimous consent: a letter from the American Civil Liberties Union, a letter from Net Choice, a letter from the Vietnam Veterans of America, which I referenced in my opening remarks, a letter from Public Knowledge, a letter and an